it's best that those who can be entirely sane do so and remain so, so that those who are struggling can see at least as possible, at least as possible. Even if they can't understand how, at least they see it as possible. But the truth is that there's nobody is insane on this planet or anywhere. In fact, there's no such thing as mental illness even on this planet. There's only continuity fear. This is a fact. There's only continuity fear. Although, what are we calling those who are insane? That is the who claim to be insane. That is the expression of continuity fear, the expression of confusion and complexity, to avoid perfection. Actually, is a distraction from the complete, simple self-evidency of the perfection of that all is. It's a distraction. It's a distraction. That's all it is. It's a pretense. All suffering is a pretense also. Now, the way to help is to help others get used to simple explanations. This is the way. So, if when they ask for answers, what they're really asking for is complexity, to distract them away from self-evidency, which they're afraid of, continuity fear. So, the way to make progress, we can say, in this context, is to hear simple answers and just hear them and don't do anything about it. Don't spin them into complexity. Okay? This is the discipline. Anyone can do this. Anyone can do this. And everyone must do it at some point. Simple answers, don't spin it into complexity. That's why I say full stop in the now. Full stop in the burn. The burn, the consternation of a simple answer, a simple response, instead of complexity, you see. The continuity fear wants complexity. And you must, with your will, say no. No complexity here. Just a very simple answer. What about the problems of the world? There is no world. Just hear that. There is no world. You say, wow. Where's the complexity? I thought I had a whole world full of complexity. But there's no world. There's no nature. There's no world. Much like one who's dreaming says, I have all these problems in a dream. No, you don't. Just stop dreaming. There's no real problems in a dream. There's no determinancy in a dream. You see, let's say we're dreaming at night and we're having all this stuff happen, and we think that there's something determinate happening in the dream. There's nothing determinate happening. The dreamer is literally dreaming up every facet of this dream. There's no inherent determinancy in a dream, right? When you go to, for instance, you go to sleep, you have this dream, all this stuff is happening in the dream, and you think, wow, you know, what is moving all this land, you know, the storyline of this dream? Well, what's doing this? And we say, wow, this must, something is all determinate. You know, this is just what's happening in the dream. No, none of it's determinate. There's not one single moment in a dream that is determined by the previous moment. It's all a story. Storylines, we're just making it up. We're imagining it. We're dreaming it. So just like in a dream, everything, to the dreamer, everything seems determinate in a dream. Like they're like passive and it's happening to them. They think, wow, all the stuff is happening to me. Determinate stuff is happening in the dream. And we know, of course, we wake up and realize, oh, I was only just imagining all this stuff. All of it was totally dependent upon my imagining. It was not dependent on some cause and effect separate from my imagining. There's no inherent cause and effect in a dream at all. Same way with this world. This world is a spiritual dream. There's no inherent cause and effect in it at all. It's 100% indeterminate from the imagination, spiritual imagination. And it's, of course, the world's an attempt to change what we are. We're trying to dream a little dream that changes what we are. And it's futile. We cannot change what we are. So we'd say, okay, well, wake up. Well, we're so into believing that we can be changed and taking this dream as determinate, when we wake up and realize that we're totally indeterminate, we're totally perfect, totally free, and it can never be otherwise other than that, we just kind of say, wow, that's too good to be true, you know, and it freaks us out. So that's a continuity problem we have. How do we go from here over to here? You know, it's just from the belief in determinacy to realization of indeterminacy, the belief in imprisonment to realization of that we're completely free. Continuity fear, so we move our comfort zone gradually here. And we do it by just hearing these total, no exceptions, no exemptions, pure, unequivocal, no exceptions, no exemptions, absolute, abstract talk and here idea, concept. What we're pointing to is just absolute, no exceptions, no exemptions, pure, unequivocal. No need to label it. Full stop in the now of hearing that. Don't spin it into complexity. Just take it in. Take it in. This is the discipline. As soon as you accept you have a continuity fear, you'll no longer be suffering from what you think is mental illness or troubles like that. You'll just say, oh, no. It's just the song my continuity fear is singing. But when I recognize that the only problem I really have is a continuity fear, I'm not struggling with that song. In fact, I'm not even really interested in it anymore. Because I know continuity fear is sure it's going to express in all sorts of ways. So I'm not really interested in that. I'm interested in what the cure for the continuity fear is, which is the vision of oneness. So now I'm focused on the vision of oneness and how to evaporate this continuity fear. I'm no longer worried about treating how the continuity fear is expressing itself, you know, what kind of song. Just take the headphones off. Let the song keep playing. Just take the headphones off. Not really even hearing it anymore. It's really like if you're listening to a song that's just, you know, terrible song. It's just like, oh, I hate this song. How do I get rid of this song? And you can't figure out how to stop the song. What can I do about this song? And it's causing me problems in my mind and stuff. And how do I cure the problems in my mind from this song and get caught up in that? Just take the headphones off. Let the song keep playing on the headphones. You're just not listening anymore. Don't need to stop the song. Just take the headphones off. I don't have a song problem. I have a continuity problem. So when you're able to accept this, it's called repentance. So I just have one problem. I know that for instance, fundamentalist Christians say there's only one way. You know, what they're really saying is there's only one problem. It's just that their terminology is a little bit, you know, it is what it is, but. What I believe they're getting at, what I'm saying, is similar, really. It's just there's only one problem. There's only one problem. This is kind of what, you know, the Christianity is getting to. Okay, it's getting to this, and I just have worked at it so intensely that I've gotten to it. All right. Through the teachings of Jesus, actually. And it's that we only have one problem. It's the continuity problem. There is no other problem whatsoever. And this is how we sidestep the world, really. And the world's belief that there's like billions of problems and all sorts of stuff to learn here and so much to, you know. No, there's nothing to learn here. There's not a billion problems. We have simply one problem. That's the continuity problem. And that's how do we set down this just insane dream of determinacy and for reality? And the answer is we take an intermediate step where we accept the belief system of indeterminacy, which I call vision of oneness, and also can express as supernature, actually. It can even express as an entire realm of supernature, which is really nature devoid of nature. Nothing to learn, no problems, just this complete stability. When nothing is happening, and you don't feel this determinate causation taking place, really. Jesus calls it a dream within a dream. the final dream that wakes us from all dreaming. So there's just this chord of extreme simplicity being played here. Abstract, pure, unequivocal, no exceptions, no exemptions whatsoever. You only have a continuity problem, no other problem. There's no other problem but the continuity problem. Be very adamant about that, and you will find yourself so centered that you feel very close to truth and not at all bothered by, you know, the highest expressions of truth. Not bothered by them at all. You just say, oh yeah, that's self-evident. I already know I have just one problem. All the other so-called problems are just distractions away from recognizing we have this just one problem. It's an expression of our fear. Distractions, so we don't recognize, oh, wait a minute, I only have one problem, and Vision of Oneness cures that, and so it's easy to cure this, but we want to fail. We say, no, it's too scary, I'm too scared. But if we understand there's this intermediate belief system of indeterminacy, it's still a belief system. So you can still say that there's concepts involved, there's some form involved, all of that, then we're not so scared at all. So, okay. Great. It's just that we're afraid to plunge into formlessness. Now, meditation, one way of looking at why it seems to work and does work, there's many ways to look at, let's put it this way. What it really does is it has you focus on one goal or one issue, and that's all you think about. So what it really does is it boils everything down to one problem, is what it is really doing. What we're saying here now is a little bit more, in my opinion, more advanced, is to say what the problem really is. It's the continuity problem. But still, for instance, paying attention to your breathing, or saying mantra over and over, you're focused on one task, one problem. No matter what, I'm just gonna have to keep counting my breath. This is a technique that's been used extensively throughout history. And the more you do that, the more all of the problems just dissipate, seemingly. And you're centered just on this one problem. Okay. So this is what often meditation is about. What we're doing here is sort of like a kind of meditation, really. And we're saying we only have one problem. We're practicing the one problemness, but we're doing it in a big context. Okay. The big clear context. But those who do meditate can probably very easily get into this. I only have one problem, it's the continuity problem. I don't have a world problem, I have a continuity problem. The world problem doesn't exist, therefore it has no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. One problem, one solution. One problem, one solution. One problem. There's no other problem. Nobody has any other problem. And just focus in on, I only have one problem. Everybody only has one problem. Everybody has exactly the same destiny. Everyone right now has exactly the same problem. In fact, there can only be just one problem, and that's the continuity problem. The only problem we as spirit can ever have is a pragmatic problem of a continuity issue. That's it. In other words, we've been dreaming and we're afraid to wake up. But all the stuff that happens in a dream is no problem for us whatsoever, never will be. The content of the dream is never a problem. It's never going to be a problem. It doesn't matter what it is. You can dream the whole universe dissolves, or whatever you want to dream. It doesn't matter. doesn't matter what you dream. The content is totally irrelevant. It's the fear of simply waking up, and the fear of to stop dreaming is the problem. The continuity fear is the only fear there really is. It's the only fear we have to deal with. So the practice, everyone has to practice just hearing these simple absolute answers. It's the only problem. There is no other problem. Just hearing it, and then the burn of this, like, I need complexity. I mean, we think we need complexity like we need air to breathe, really. If we think, if we don't have complexity, troubles, problems, all, you know, we're afraid, like, how can I even exist? We're afraid we'll stop existing. Well, if we define this dreaming as existing, we would stop dreaming. But we have this other dream, the dream of indeterminacy, the dream, the beautiful dream of supernature. Buddhists call it the pure land, the pure land. There's various terms for it, different religions. It's this beautiful dream of supernature. If there was no change taking place, let's say, how could you say, well, there's this chain of causation taking place? Don't we need like some kind of change? Okay, this was this, and now it's different than this. If there was just something the sameness, it'd be pretty difficult to establish, say, there's the causation, wouldn't it? Some kind of force that is causing something to change. Now keep in mind, we want to change what we are. This dream is a dream of changing what we are. So if we just, everything was just perfectly the same, exactly the same, no change taking place, that'd be pretty difficult to believe that we're changing what we are, wouldn't it? So of course this dream we're having is a dream of change. And we're saying that this change is determinate. In other words, it's automatically happening, instead of us imagining that it's happening. You get that? In other words, we think that it doesn't matter what we imagine, it's still going to happen. Like, we're still going to die. So it doesn't matter if we sit here and say, no, I'm not going to die. We're still going to die. In other words, it's totally determinate. It's like, so we're having this dream saying, no, everything that's happening in the dream is determinate. It has nothing to do with us imagining the dream. Because we want to believe that there's some way to change what we are. And obviously, if we're just imagining this all, you know, it's pretty difficult to even believe that this could have any effect on us whatsoever, because we would know that it's all completely indeterminate. See? It's all, we were just making it all up, and there's no causation at all. So how could we think that there's some force that somehow can cause causation, cause change in us? We'd realize, no, it's impossible. It's not happening. So we stop from time to time like this and just keep centering ourselves in the absolute simplicity of it, self-evidency of it, no complexity of it. Don't spin it into complexity. Don't spin it into questions or answers or anything like that. Just take it. You know truth is self-evident. So there isn't any need to question truth. Now, anyone can question my words or someone's words or the structure, sentence structure, but repentant, when you're repentant, you don't worry about that. Don't worry about it. You say, I know this is, I'm practicing simplicity. I'm practicing full stop and now. That's all I have to do. I don't have to worry. Automatically, the better we get at that, the clarity automatically will arrive. The self-evidency will automatically start. It's like burning off the clouds. The sun will automatically shine. You don't have to make the sun shine. Right? Just burn off the clouds, and the sun's already there. So the truth is already within us. We just have to evaporate the mist, to evaporate. So don't worry about the words, how the words are structured, could they be structured another way, and all this kind of stuff. Just say, oh, it's not important. Just I'm getting it, I'm practicing, I've got consternation, that's great. Don't let me spin into complexity. See, when I say full stop in the now, full stop in this burn, full stop in the wow, don't spin it into any complexity, any strategies, any entanglement. Just stay in the wow of it, the burn of it. It doesn't really matter. We don't have to write a story about all the different movement of the clouds as it evaporates and everything. No, it evaporates. Who cares how the forms shift and move around? It doesn't matter. Just evaporate it. The sun is already shining. You see, it doesn't require us to have some path of, you know, we don't need to say, okay, because I did this cloud move this way and this lightened up over here and this, because of that, therefore the sun is shining. No, see, now the sun is shining regardless of any motion or any path of getting rid of the clouds. The sun's already there. It's not dependent. The shining of the sun is not dependent on what particular steps that were taken in order to evaporate the clouds. It's just that when the clouds are evaporated, we realize the sun has always been there. And it's not dependent on any our actions, any sequence at all that we're taking. Our being is not dependent on any actions, our sequence of actions that we are taking. Whether we divide the clouds this way, or divide them this way, or spin the clouds, make the clouds go past one another or something. This cloud here, this cloud over here, this one moves here, we shift the clouds around this way and that way in different shapes. The sun is not dependent on any of that. It's already there. It's already shining. So we drop the play of concepts as unimportant. It's not important. And lo and behold, it evaporates. You know, the sun, we realize, oh, the sun is shining. It's just that our attention is on all moving these clouds around, thinking like, how do I get the sun to shine here? How do I get the sun? If we just looked up, for instance, let's say we're right at the top of this layer of clouds. Above us is the sun, below us are all these clouds. And we're looking, our attention is looking down on all these clouds and saying, how can I get these clouds to clear up, you know? What do I have to do? Maybe I gotta change things down here. Now, how come all they're producing all these clouds? How about just looking up and say, oh, the sun is shining. These clouds are not affecting the sun at all. So when we say we're evaporating our continuity fear, are we evaporating the clouds, or are we evaporating our fear of just looking up and seeing, oh, the sun is there? See? Right? Think about that. Consider that. It's like we're sitting in this chair, and we're floating on top of the clouds, and all our attention is down there on the clouds, and says, what are these human beings doing? They're causing all these problems, and there's troubles here, and this, and I've got to get rid of those clouds. I gotta, clear up those clouds before I can see the sun. But if we just got our attention off looking down and looked up, we would see the sun is shining perfectly. It's never been affected by the clouds. Never will be. In fact, we've just been hallucinating those clouds. They don't really exist. So we're obsessed with our hallucination, all these clouds we've been hallucinating, thinking, how do I sort these out? How do I categorize these? How do I label these? How do I stack these? Okay, now can I move this over? It's a chess match we're trying to figure out. What do I got to do to put these clouds so I can finally be enlightened? And but the real issue is our continuity fear. We're afraid to move our attention. So habits of attention are all important. Gradually, we got to get our attention off of trying to solve all these cloud problems of the world and simply look up and see, the sun is perfect. Continuity fear, right? I'm doing that. Because then we'll say, I don't have to do anything. You'll say, oh my gosh, this is all a dream. I don't have to do anything. I have to. And you say, whoa, wait a minute. Scary, right? So, continuity of fear is the only problem we have. If we're sitting on this chair in the top of this cloud layer and we're not looking up at the sun and we're looking down, obsessed with what we have to do with all these clouds, and our attention completely preoccupied by all these swirling dark clouds, and we're just, my brain, just terrible, all these problems. If we're preoccupied with that, then what's our problem? It's really a continuity problem. Because at any moment, without that continuity problem, we would just look up and see, the sun, everything's perfect. Ground of being is perfect, still there. No. So it's only this continuity fear, afraid of shifting our attention, is the only problem we have. We realize that the clouds cannot obscure the sun, then we're not concerned about our hallucinations. We're not concerned about hallucinating anymore. So I don't need to keep hallucinating clouds. That's ridiculous. There's nothing, no lessons to be learned. There's nothing to learn by studying these clouds. Yeah, just imagine we're sitting in this chair for millions and millions of years studying these clouds, trying to figure something out from these ever-changing clouds. There's nothing to figure out. There's no knowledge to be gained from studying clouds. Again, when people have trouble understanding all this, it's because they're trying to make it complex. They're trying to say, well, what is it that you're understanding about these clouds that tells you, that shows you that there's nothing you need to learn about clouds? How did you figure that out from these clouds? Can you explain this to me? And I'll say, well, I'm here to help you get used to simple explanations. So that's what I'm going to give you, a simple explanation. Which is simply shift your attention up to the sun and realize the clouds are not blocking the sun at all. And then, obviously, that's all you need to know. So you don't need to know anything. You don't need the clouds to tell you anything. And they say, well, what, how did you shift? Well, continuity fear. Hearing these simple answers and then full stop in hearing this in the burn. In other words, stop talking. Stop asking questions. You just heard the truth. And it's like, when people hear the truth, they think that they need to then suddenly start asking a bunch of questions. Now, the discipline is the exact opposite. When you hear the simple truth, that's when you discipline yourself to not ask any questions. Not project ahead. How do I need to interrogate this? How do I need to break this down? How do I need to put this in a cloud context? We don't put it in a cloud context. So, as soon as you stop trying to spin in the complexity, you're evaporating the continuity fear. And so you are on the path. Absolutely. It's that simple. And of course, people think, no, wait a minute. I need to understand complexity. I need to get used to complexity. No, there is no complexity, the truth. You need to get used to no complexity. people say, well, how do I get the reflection of perfection? How do I understand perfection through imperfection? Or you don't really understand it. Now, but even that's a question. Don't even ask. Try not to ask questions. It is the key. Because any self-evidency talk is really pointing to the fact that the sun is already shining there. Our spirit is within us, is everywhere, and is perfect. So it's pointing to that directly, and this is what freaks us out. So you have to then just abide in this freak out as best as possible, and just watch the movements of your defense systems, defensive reactions, and just don't struggle with the struggle. Just observe the struggle that's going on, like, and don't let it carry you away. You start thinking, hey, this would make a great movie. Now let me see who the actors and actresses would be. Let me think of a script. Oh, stop. Just keep it simple, indeterminate, in the now. Don't spin it into complexity. Don't spin it into a storyline. Don't spin it into any story. There's no cloud story of how the cloud story gave rise to the sun, okay? See, people are lost in this story. Say, how can I come up with this story that accounts for the sun shining up there, you know? What do the clouds have to do with this? Nothing. The clouds had nothing to do with it. The clouds are an attempt to change the fact that the sun is shining. It's trying to stop it from shining, actually. So the clouds don't have anything to do with the sun shining. So to ask a story like how did the clouds get the sun to shine is whimsically ridiculous. So, all of us, we go into teaching, and we want answers, and we want to figure out what kind of cloud formation did you come up with, and how did you arrange these clouds, and why did you get so lucky to get the answer finally from the story of how did clouds get the sun to shine? There is no such question. So that's why when we get the teaching, it's like so difficult. We say, this doesn't seem to be answering my question. It's the wrong question. If there's no answer, how can there be a question? If the whole premise is mistaken, how can there be a question? It's like saying, how did I get the sun to shine? It's always been shining. So there is no, how did I get it? There's no this and then that. So we're saying, if this, then how that? There is no if this. If the clouds caused the sun to shine, you know, then what kind of causation was there? The clouds did not cause the sun to shine, so you can't say there's zero causation. You can, but the unrepentant will say, oh, okay, so you're saying it could be causation. Yeah. This is . kind of like the someone who's really desperate. There's the sort of the social meme of like someone saying, is there any chance that you and I could be an item? Is that possible? And they say, ah, you know, it's like one in a million. And oh, you're saying there's a chance then. You know, it's like that. So when we say there's zero causation, you're saying, oh, you're saying there's a chance. It's zero, but it could be not zero. It could be one. You know, no, zero causation is not the same. It's not a number. It means there's no chance. But the unrepentant will not see it that way. As long as you use words, they think you're saying there's a chance. So this is the trouble. When I say you must repent, this is true. Otherwise, nothing that is said will convey the fact that there's no chance of the clouds causing the sun to shine, or anything causing the sun to shine. Original cause, original nature, is not caused by anything. There's zero causation. Okay. And zero doesn't mean one less than one. Okay, it does not mean one step away from one. It does not mean that at all. And if you can understand that, then you're repentant. You're a repentant spirit. You're not still a rebellious spirit. You're a repentant spirit. If you can understand that zero is not just one less than one. Like one is one less than two. Okay, let's say you have two coins, you take away one, you say, oh, I have one less coin now. But when you have one coin and you take that away, you don't say, oh, I have one less coin now. No, you don't. You don't have any coin. It's different. It's fundamentally different, actually. Zero is not simply one less than one. There's zero causation. There's nothing that's no causation at all. Doesn't mean, oh, you're saying I have a chance. It doesn't mean that at all. And that's the difference between those who get it and those who don't. It's a matter of repentance. And repentance is the ones who realize they don't have any option except to evaporate this continuity fear and realize the uncaused original nature that all is. There's no option to not do that, actually. Ultimately, it has to be done. There's no way around it. The repentant realize that there's no exception or exemption for them or for anybody. They have to do it. And then they realize, I can't keep playing this silly game of thinking that zero is just one less than one. That's just a silliness, actually. And playing these games with words, thinking, well, I can twist the words and twix the meanings and play this game. Well, you know, so this is a way to tell. If have you really repented? Are you tripping up on words constantly? Or are you just saying, forget, I hear it. Let me just feel this burning consternation. Let me just feel this. Let me just focus on, just stay focused, indeterminate, don't spin it into complexity, keep the discipline. If you're doing that, then for sure you are on the spiritual path. Which means for sure you're having success. Which means for sure you're evaporating the continuity fear. Which means for sure you're going to have breakthroughs, subtle breakthroughs. Which for me happened just constantly, 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 constantly seeing clearer and clearer and clearer and clearer. But you'll get people that are willing to argue with you from now till the end of time that zero is just one less than one. You know, that they're willing to, and they're basically saying, I'm so scared I want to believe that it's not even possible to resolve the continuity fear, so I'm going to defend that position no matter what. It's not possible. So I want to just confuse terminology and words, right? And willfully, sillily stay confused. I mean, I insisted upon it. They'll insist on their right to stay confused, which, of course, they have the right to stay confused temporarily, but ultimately, you know, we can't change what we are. So, and we're not happy with futility. So it's ultimately, it's inescapable. We have to evaporate this continuity fear. It's inescapable. Totally inescapable. And so the repentance spirits realize this is totally inescapable. So there's nothing to do except go to work. That's it. And they might be very glum, you know. So yeah, I mean, the path is like, wow, what a difficulty. You know, it's just like, wow. So we often seem sort of glum and serious and feeling like we're almost enslaved by this effort. It's so difficult and all. But they have no choice. We have to do it. And so we might as well be as happy as we can without forcing anything, without struggling with the struggle. If we're struggling, don't try to force the struggle of happiness upon it. Just say, okay, don't struggle with the struggle. You know, it's like one and zero again. The ones who want to confuse it, it's like saying that waking up from a dream is just another dream state. No, it isn't. It's not. It's not another dream state. Ultimate awakening is not another dream state. Just like zero is not a numerical value. It's just a symbolic placeholder for when we say, well, one is not an absence of all value. See, there's a value. So the absence of all value, absence of all numbers is not a number. Absence of all valuing is not a value. So just hear this, don't spin it into complexity. Don't say, okay, I'm going to teach my class tomorrow, an arithmetic class about this. And no, don't do that, you see. Don't put yourself in the role of teacher about anything, because that's spinning it into complexity. Don't say, wow, when I'm a guru, I'm going to really teach this. I'm going to think, how am I going to teach this now? That's spinning it into complexity. What are my students going to think about this? That's spinning it into complexity. No student, no teaching, no teacher, no student. Stay in this, no teacher, no teaching student, indeterminate, no spin into complexity, full stop in the now, full stop in the wow, full stop in the burn mode, repentant spirit, not a rebellious spirit, repentant spirit, getting used to self-evidency, the absolute simplicity of self-evidency. The absence of all numbers is not a number. It's not just one less number than one. You see, the absence of all numbers is not just one less number than one, is it? It's no number at all. No number at all can't be just one less number than anything, can it? No value at all isn't just lesser value than the one, you know, one step of lesser value than some other value, right? It's not a step, lesser step. So, okay, now I have zero value, that's a lesser step than one value. No, it's no value at all, it's not a step. So the end of the path is not a step. This is very important. As long as we're looking for the end to be a step, it won't happen. Steps are only relative to other value. This value relative to this value relative to this value. A path is only relative to this valuing. Okay, but to end the path is not another step of valuing. It's the realization you're abiding in no step land. There's no way to step out of it. There's no way to step into it and no way to step out of it. One times zero is zero. Okay. There's no way to step out of zero. Okay. Numbers are not a progression out of zero. Numbers, one is only relative to other numbers. It's not relative to one, to zero in terms of numerically. It's not numerically relative to zero. Just as the non-duality is not relative to duality. It's not just an outcome of duality. It's not a cessation of duality. It's not an ending of duality. It's the condition, it's the one condition where there's never been any duality. Never will be. This should be producing a burn. If it's not, then you're already enlightened. I mean, don't need any teaching at all. No, you'd already be aware you're abiding in non-dualness. Instead of your attention would be fully aware of this. Otherwise, this is going to bring about a burn for sure. Which is good. We're able to get to the spiritual buzz. This is like you can feel it. Just like it's kind of a fear, it's a consternation. It's just a wow. So this is what we're after. This is what we're after. It's getting into this deep seated consternation. Bringing that up, bringing that to surface. And then this is where the real practice comes in, is the discipline now, of just don't spin it into complexity. I mean, this brings up upset, it brings up consternation. It just, because, you know, you're finally struck by the truth of this. It's just, wow. Everything I've done has just been a waste of time. But don't even label it, to just let the consternation be there. Don't even spin it into a complexity at all of labeling. Just pure unequivocal, no exception, no exemptionness. Just let it hit home, just let it hit home. Don't medicate the reaction. Don't do anything with it. It's kind of like just watching the pot boil. Just let it boil. It's evaporating. It's kind of like we brought ourselves to a boil here. Okay, just let it evaporate. Just let it keep boiling. you're already boiling, don't try to figure it out. How did I get this boiling? You already did it. Don't make spin it into complexity. It's already been done. We just did it in this video. But just now, experience the fruits of that effort. Don't go back in your memory. Don't go forward. So how can I keep it boiling? It's already boiling. So that's good enough. You can feel like you're feeling very shaky ground, okay? There's another way of putting it, consternation, very shaky ground. Your identity, conceptuality, everything suddenly feels now it's on extremely shaky ground, very thin ice. Another way of putting it is your belief that there's some pit that you've been in is on very shaky ground. You're seeing like, hey, I never was in any pit. Now, from the standpoint of the absolute, you don't have to worry about steps. You can see this conceptual cloud structure floating there. You don't have to worry, think about, well, how do I step into that? Or how do I step out of it? You're everywhere. There's no stepping into or out of it at all. You're already, pure spaciousness is saturating everything. It's only when you are trying to put yourself in the cloud and then you say, how do I step out of it, is the problem. What you realize is you've never been in the cloud. You've been everywhere. And that includes the cloud, includes everything. So you might say, I've always been only everywhere. Now, let's say you have these grandiose notions and all this kind of stuff. Okay, that's fine. That's just the cloud structure. You don't have to step out because you've never been in there. Just say, I've always been only everywhere. And so you don't have to identify with that cloud as grandiose. There can be billions of grandiose clouds. It doesn't bother you at all. There's no need to step out of any of them because I've always been only everywhere. Now, one of the troubles with people who are disturbed is they think that spiritual teachers are not interested in, we're not trying to be helpful or whatever, just the opposite. Those are exactly the ones who need to practice this. Those are the ones we're speaking to. Jesus said, I didn't come to save the righteous, I came to save the sinners, so to speak, right? The Sadducees thought they never did anything wrong, and that ritually sacrifices took care of whatever they did wrong was somehow expiated, but through that, and so they didn't have to do any work on themselves. So Jesus said, well, that's fine. I didn't come to save the righteous. I came to save the sinners, the ones who, you know, have troubles that need to clear up. So, of course, Jesus is speaking to those who are mentally troubled. So what I found is those who are mentally troubled always say, well, that's great advice, but you know, it doesn't apply to me. Yes, it does. Absolutely it does. But I gotta figure out how to get out of this cloud. Now, I've always been only everywhere. I've always been only everywhere. Just rest at that. Then suddenly you feel very shaky, like, wow. But you're not sure, am I coming out of the cloud? Or where am I standing now? No, I've always been only everywhere. I've always been only everywhere. So let the cloud flow past you. It doesn't matter. No longer. Just let any cloud flow wherever it wants to flow. It doesn't matter. It doesn't concern me. How to get into it or how to get out of it is no question. There's no question at all. I've always been only everywhere. Wherever I go, I'm always exactly where I've always been. Wherever I go, I'm always exactly where I've always been. I've always been only everywhere. Wherever I go, I'm always exactly where I've always been. I've always been only everywhere. I've always been only everywhere. Wherever I go, I'm always exactly where I've always been. I've only been always everywhere. I've always been only everywhere. Wherever I go, I'm always exactly where I've always been. I've only been always everywhere. As soon as we make an exception, then we're making a step. And of course, one can't step into zero. Okay, there's no step into zero. Zero is not a step. How can we step into everywhere? How can we say it's a step? How can it be a determinate step? Because we're stepping, we say, okay, I'm stepping into this place. But I've always been only everywhere. Wherever I go, I'm always exactly where I've always been. How can we step into where we've always been? How can we step into where we've always been? How can we step into where we've always been? I've only been always everywhere. I've always been only everywhere. I've always been only everywhere. I've always been only everywhere. Wherever I go, I'm always exactly where I've always been. So how can I take a step into where I am? We can't take any steps. We can't step into where I am. And people get frightened, well, I'll never get there. No, you can never step out of it. You never stepped out of it. I've always been only everywhere. If I've always been only everywhere. I've always been only everywhere. And wherever I go, I'm always exactly where I've always been. How can we step out of that or step into that? See? Of course, this is causing this. But the truth is, we're on the groundless ground. As long as we see it in a certain way, it seems shaky. But when we see it from another way, how could there be shakiness? If I'm on the groundless ground, how can the groundless ground be shaken? Stirred? How can it be disturbed? How can the groundless ground be disturbed? And the shaky ground we're on is say, wait a minute, I got a continuity fear. I need some disturbance. I need some disturbance, you know. And so that's where our disturbances are come into play, right? Our so-called mental disturbances come into play because we want some disturbance. Saw a video just recently of a five-part series of ashrams and spiritual masters in India. Very well done by an amateur on YouTube. And presents beautifully presented. The last ashram guru that was in the part five, last part, was Punjaji. And when his picture came up and he was talking, it's like I immediately just sort of like this, you know, love leapt out. I said, oh, I love this. I love what he, I love the, what this, you know, you see, he's speaking the truth. I love this. This is terrific. Now, maybe just because maybe he's more contemporary than the others, a lot of the others actually, or maybe he's just, you know, truly realized. there are others that were truly realized, like Raman Maharshi for sure. But there's something about Punjaji where I reacted like, ah, I just love what he's saying. I love the truth because he's expressing the truth. You know, the truth is realized in the groundless ground. There's no shakiness there. No disturbance there. And so what I've said, I love this no disturbance-ness. I love this no disturbance. There's no disturbance there. I could feel it from him just emanating. I could feel it. There's no disturbance there. I said, this is what I love. This is what I love. There's no mental ill. There's no mental disturbances in Punjaji. You see, there's none there. And so you feel, oh, this is what I really want. This is what I really want. It's too bad I didn't get to see him when he was here, but I wasn't ready. He wasn't ready. Now, there's a lot who say they're enlightened by him. Maybe they were, or through his grace, or this triggered or helped them accept their own perfect lack of disturbance freeness. It's very possible, right? It's also possible that some had a concept of disturbance freeness and thought that was enlightenment. Had an enlightened concept of no disturbance instead of abiding in no disturbance. That's possible too. Maybe both happened, you know. But he makes it very clear. You have to get rid of, you know, let go the concept of freedom, of happiness, bliss, all this. Let go of that too. Is it still just a concept? Let go of that too. That's still a ground. He's in the groundless ground. The ground free ground. I've always been only everywhere. Wherever I go, I'm always exactly where I've always been. I've always been only everywhere. Where's the ground of that? Where's the disturbance? There's no disturbance. So, the disturbance-free, abiding in that which is disturbance-free, is what we're afraid of. That's the success we're trying to fail at. That's what we're trying to fail at, most people. Here, we're trying to succeed at it, actually. But the world, because of the continuity fear, tries to fail at this. It says, just give me a better disturbance, please. Can you just show me a better disturbance? You know, those who are struggling with disturbance, say, wow, I'm just so tired of this disturbance. It's really disturbing me. Can you give me a better disturbance? And the answer is yes, because spiritual practice is a better disturbance. Okay? It is. It's controlling your disturbance. It's getting a better disturbance. It's, hey, this full stop in this disturbance is a better disturbance than struggling with the disturbance. You see? It is better. Take it from one who's been through all of this. Okay? All of it. It's a way better disturbance than the ones that you're going through. For sure it is. And I totally understand all these disturbances. In fact, they're endless. They're endless. I've been through so many. It seems like I went through all the mental disturbances. I was trying to look at all of them, you know. And it's just like, so I just lay asleep at night and there's just like this incredible play of mental disturbance. Millions of just thoughts and disturbances. This went on for just decades. You know, just, wow. I just was watching this show of mental disturbance. I said, this is interesting. You know, and so it's really endless. The types of mental disturbance are infinite. Okay. So you better find a better mental disturbance with just a spiritual path. Full stop in the mental disturbance. Full stop in the indeterminacy. Full stop in the groundlessness. Full stop in the thin iceness. Like, whoa, I'm on the thin ice of no mental disturbance. No disturbance. Oh my gosh. Now this is more interesting, actually, than all these other mental disturbances. Full stop in the, I only have one problem, the continuity problem. That's my disturbance. So what you do is you trade in all these infinite mental disturbances for just one, and that is, I have a continuity disturbance, a problem. Trade it in, and it's absolutely the way to go. Absolutely the way to go. Realize that the real disturbance is I feel like I'm right on the thin ice of no disturbance. And that's true. In fact, eventually we realize there's not even any ice there at all. But we can feel like for a while like we're on this thin ice. Because what we are cannot be disturbed. What we are cannot be disturbed. What is cannot be disturbed. So we're on that thin ice. And just being disturbed by that and not struggling with that disturbance is what evaporates the continuity fear. You see, we take on this one disturbance. Wow, I'm on the very thin ice of no disturbance here. Full stop in that. Don't make it complex at all. Don't spin into complexity. Just sit in it. Sit there and just say, wow, I'm on thin ice of no disturbance here. Holy cow. And then don't make disturbances, additional ones, you see. Just let that one disturbance and just abide with that one disturbance. So we're trading in all mental disturbances for this one disturbance. This is what my advice. So I don't need to talk about all these mental disturbances because they're infinite. And what happens is you start talking about them, someone who's mentally in these disturbances, and it just goes from one disturbance to another disturbance, and it just remains spinning your wheels. Doesn't go anywhere. It's hell. Been there, done that. No question, it's hell. Now, it seems interesting because you think like you become some genius because you're seeing like millions of mental disturbances. You think, wow, maybe I'll be able to like solve all these and give answers to each one. But after a while, you say, wow, I'm getting tired of this. You know, this is really disturbing. Very disturbing. Too disturbing. And you say, does anybody have an answer? Does anybody have an answer? Absolutely. There's answers right here. Trade all those in for this one, the one great wonderful disturbance is I'm very disturbed that I'm sitting on this thin ice of no disturbance. Stop right there, full stop right there. And just feel that disturbance, and you're shaking and trembling. Smile and say, okay, it's fine. And then I said, I'm just evaporating this continuity fear is all I'm doing. Remember, all disturbance, mental disturbances are just distractions away from this one disturbance of feeling disturbed that we're sitting in the thin ice of no disturbance. We're just distractions. So just go back to the root disturbance, the one disturbance of this continuity issue. Like, oh my gosh, what? Going to realize that it's impossible for me to be disturbed. What do I do? Oh my gosh, you see, that's the thin ice that everybody's on. We're all on that thin ice. It's like, what if you went into this bathtub, big bathtub, and someone told you it's like boiling hot, and what you got to do is you got to like get in there and not move. Don't pay any attention to how it feels. So you get in there and you're just like frozen up, you're not even thinking. Now, what if the truth of the matter was that the water really wasn't hot or boiling hot at all? It was like perfect temperature for you. And so the thing is, it's perfect temperature and you can't feel it. You know, you can't feel anything. It's like, wow. It's working, I'm all frozen up, that's why I'm not feeling the boiling water. And you get so tired of that, someone eventually tells you the truth, and you gradually relax, and then realize you've been feeling it all along, you've been in it, it's been perfect temperature all along, you just didn't know it. So it's not like you had to wait for the temperature to go down or anything to happen. Just it was a mistake, was believing that it was boiling. Now again, the disturbances will say, well, this is very nice talk, but what about my disturbance? Always, right? That's great. But what about the disturbance that I have? Can you explain that? How to solve that? Now trade in all disturbances, which are infinite, actually. Because people say they have one disturbance. No, they don't. They have so many complexes of disturbances. Trade them all in for this one disturbance, and just say, okay, this is now my disturbance. I own this disturbance. This is mine. I'm on thin ice of no disturbance. I'm not worried about answers to all these other disturbances. Forget it. I just want the answer to this one. This one. That's it. It's interesting seeing that Punjaji talking and looking at that video. I just felt like I wanted to just sort of hug him, put my head next to his, and just bliss out. You know, that's it. I didn't have any questions, anything to say, or nothing else. I just just, that's it, just. No disturbance. I just wanted to join him in no disturbance land, you know, which has always been only everywhere. Wherever I go, I'm always exactly where I've always been. So that's a good reaction. It's a good reaction. It was just spontaneous. It truly just, it was just spontaneous. It just arose spontaneously. I never felt that way about him before or anyone. I just suddenly just boom, just like, wow. This is my reaction towards no disturbance. Not the, you know, the feature, the form of the body. No, just reaction towards no disturbance. Pundaji was just reading no disturbance. So my reaction to that was, oh, wonderful. I just want to be with that. There's no questions, no answers, no, just, yeah, that's it. So, when you say, oh, okay, what about my problems? Oops, I only have one problem. Continuity problem. I'm on the brink of no disturbance at all. That's it. I'm right on the brink of no disturbance at all. That's like somebody saying, I'm right on the brink of no cliff at all. Think about that. I'm right on the brink of no cliff at all. I'm right on the brink of no pit at all. I'm right on the brink of no problem at all. I'm right on the brink of no disturbance whatsoever. Wow, let that be my disturbance, that my one disturbance. And just say, okay. If somebody's like shaking and tearing, they're gonna fall off a cliff, they fall on the cliff. And I say, wow, I'm just teetering on the brink of no cliff at all. Teetering on the brink of no cliff at all. And just look at that, you know. And just stay with it, okay. It's great disturbance, very frightened, right? Wow. I'm just completely teetering on the brink here of no cliff whatsoever. I got this severe problem of no problem whatsoever. I'm feeling so problematical about this. Good, just full stop right there. Just see for what it is. This is what I'm afraid of. Great. I had to drive today up a mountain, to dangerous mountain roads and stuff. And I got up in the morning, I was really scared of death and accidents and stuff. I said, wow, this is not good. And this road, and the sun had just come up and was directly into my windshield. And I run out of wiper fluid. And the inside of the truck window was also covered with dust, and I hadn't cleaned it in a long time. And it struck this windshield, and the combination of all this dirt and dust, I couldn't see anything. I couldn't even see the road. It was horrible. So as soon as I could, I pulled off the road. I said, I can't drive like this. This is incredibly dangerous. I mean, there's like somebody walking in front of the car, a deer or something. I couldn't see anything. Car pulls out, whatever. So I had some drinking water, and I in a rag, and I cleaned the windshield outside, and I cleaned it inside, and then I was able to see again. So I was driving along. Lo and behold, a deer did jump out in front of the truck a little ways later, actually. But I was still worried about accidents. And I delayed just a little bit from leaving. Just took a little delay talk, or maybe a couple minutes or minute, and just a little bit. And I drove slowly and stuff. And lo and behold, going down this freeway, dangerous freeway, and suddenly all the traffic stops and it's backed up. I say, "Oh, what's going on?" Well, we get people start pull over left lane. Really, could see something bad's happened up here. And there's this huge truck full of heavy gravel or something, big dump truck. And I said, "Oh boy!" And I went past that, and there were three cars, passenger cars, that were just side by side, pancake side by side, and everything was under the guardrail. I mean, it was like a four vehicle accident, including the truck, and they were pulling people out of their vehicles and everything. Just went past and said, "Wow, really, really nasty accident. Hopefully, I believe everyone was okay, just shaken up, maybe injured a little bit, but I think that, you know, I think everybody was still alive. The cars crumpled up nicely and everything they were supposed to." But you know, if I hadn't delayed just a little bit like that, or I hadn't taken my time and just feel hadn't sidestepped it, you know, the timing, I might have been right there. See, I could have been right in that accident area. So I came along just a little bit afterwards, just a little bit after it happened, a couple minutes or something, right? So if we're aware that we only have this one problem, we might not be so, we say, "Well, I don't really have to like be into the world's all these issues right now, because I'm going to be working on this problem, but this, I feel I'm really disturbed, I'm on the brink of no disturbance. And well, let me just sit here quietly, let me work on this for a little while." Okay, now, we could very well end up sidestepping very serious problems in this world. Okay, these were nice cars that got this accident. These were rich people's cars, okay. These were Lexus SUVs. I mean, you know, just like, see, it happens to nice cars too. Accidents happen to nice cars too, don't they? Rich people too. These were, you know, wealthy, affluent people that just, this horrible dump truck just, you know, I mean, I don't know what happened, but it was not good. What we're doing here is realizing we don't have to worry about all these other problems. These are not our issues anymore at all, right? So this whole world full of problems, we don't need it. Don't need it. If we accept our only problem is that we, this continuity problem that I have, this, our only disturbance is that I feel like I'm teetering on the brink of no cliffness. There's no cliff. I'm disturbed that I'm on the brink of no disturbance. If we accept this is our only problem, what do we need the world for, actually? What do we need all these problems in the world for? We don't need them, do we? We don't need them. Now, we can carry this problem with us wherever we go. We can say, "Yeah, I do. You know, I'm kind of scared. I don't have any problems." So we can say, "Okay, I do have this problem. I know what it is. I'm teetering on the brink of no cliff." See? I am so disturbed. I'm almost in no disturbance. I feel I'm thin ice. I'm right on the brink of no disturbance. If we know that, own it. This is my problem. It's the only problem I have. This opens up possibilities for us, doesn't it? Fundamentally alters our destiny. Fundamentally alters it, doesn't it? If there was a guru here like Punjaji, we could say, "Punjaji, I only have one problem, and that is I feel I'm right on the brink of my disturbance is that I'm right on the brink of no disturbance whatsoever." So I can tell you're already except the no disturbances. Yeah. Can I just sit here with you? Can I just tag along with you? Can I do this? That's all I want to do. Is I just want to get used to this. You know, see if I can, you know, get used to this. Help me out. So, yeah, I said, sure. Just no teaching, no teacher, no student. Just be quiet. Just don't have to ask questions. You already know what your problem is. You just need to dissolve this fear. So just in proximity to one who has no disturbance at all, you just sit there in proximity. You just hang out. Well, this could be true for a guru. It could also be true for entire realm. A nature-free nature realm, so a supernatural realm, is you just say, wow, there's no problem here at all. No disturbance at all. Can I just hang out here with my problem? I'm you know, nervous about no disturbance, but I know that's my only problem, so I just need to get used to it, gradually get used to it. I just hang out. I don't have any complexity of questions. So, you see, it opens up these options, doesn't it? It absolutely does. So I invite everybody, no matter what they think their disturbances have been, because disturbances, again, can be your infinite number. It doesn't matter, since whatever it is, we're trading it in for this one disturbance. Okay? It doesn't matter whatever your disturbances have been, and there have probably been many, 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 many complexes and so many disturbances and stuff. We've all been through all sorts of disturbances. Doesn't matter, just trade them all in. No longer. You've traded them in, now you just have this one disturbance. It doesn't matter what happened to those other disturbances, because actually realize it was just the avoidance of accepting you have this one disturbance. It was a distraction. They're just distractions. Once you no longer need to be distracted, you don't need the distractions. You don't need to say, where did my distractions go? Because you don't need them anymore. You don't care where they went. They're just simply not arising, you know. So, you didn't heal them. I mean, you just say, I don't need them anymore. Distractions aren't something you heal. It's you just say, you don't need them anymore. We're not suffering from something that needs to be healed. We're suffering from this one disturbance that we're trying to distract ourselves from. So once we accept this one disturbance and see what it is, we simply don't need those other disturbances. That's all. Don't need them anymore. So the whole idea of healing is mistaken, in my opinion. The way I'm showing it to you here is very much mistaken. We don't worry about healing anything. If you say, I gotta heal this distraction, then you hold on to it, right? It's like, I got this illness, I got to heal this illness, I'm going to hold on to it. Now I just say, this illness is just a distraction, I don't need it anymore. It's just a disturbance, I don't need it anymore. I've accepted the true one disturbance of continuity fear. Whoops, I'm on the brink of no disturbance whatsoever. Wow, I'm on the thin ice, I feel I'm just about to have no disturbance at all. Oh my gosh, you see. The other stuff, all imaginary distractions we've been dreaming up, and we just stop dreaming them. We just don't need them anymore. So that's not a healing. That's not a healing. It's just you don't need to arise anymore. It's like let's say you go to a drinking fountain and you push the drinking fountain down like a school or something, and the water comes out of the fountain and you think, how can I stop this water? And using your other hand, trying to play with the water and trying to put your thumb on it and stop it and say, I stop this, you know. And then you realize, just stop, you know, pushing down the lever, that, you know, just let go of the lever, take your hand off, the water stops. It's like that. See, how did I stop it with this hand? And he didn't. You did it with this hand. You see, don't need it anymore. Don't need it anymore. So give up healing for sure. Give up all notion of healing anything. Nobody will ever be healed at all. They'll just realize they don't need this distraction. It's just an imaginary distraction. Just stop producing it. Just like you stop holding down that handle of the water fountain, you stop holding it down, the water stops. So this is powerful stuff. So of course you're going to be reverberating. There'll be reverberations from this. Absolutely. And you may say, wow, so intense. Well, the times are very intense here in this world. Very intense. And what this world is going to say is like, hey, we've got like all sorts of healing modalities for your disturbances. And so they say, you need to hold on to those disturbances so we can heal them. Address these, all these disturbances. You got so many disturbances. We were going to work on those. Really going to spend a lot of time working on your disturbances. So of course you're going to hold on to them. Say, oh, good, good, good. So like a pharmaceutical company saying, you know, we're going to come out really soon with this really nice chemical that's going to help balance, you know, the serotonin levels in your brain or something. Oh yeah, it's going to have like a ton of side effects, and but still, you know, it's an improvement. And so, you know, just hold on for a little. Almost got. We're doing in trials now. We're doing some clinical trials, and as soon as we finish with the clinical trials, get the FDA's approval, and it'll be ready for you. See? And they say, okay, good, good. I need to hold on to my. In my imbalance, my disturbance, so I can heal it. You know, I can heal it. So this is the world. This is the future of this world. Is they're going to come up with, you know, thousands and hundreds of thousands, maybe millions of healing modalities, and it's going to become so complex it'll drive you crazy. Yeah, absolutely crazy. It's like that new ad by SAP saying, the problem in the world that technology has caused is too much technology. It's gotten too complex. And it's going to get way worse, like exponentially worse very soon, by 2020. It will be absolutely off the charts complex and nobody will be able to function. And it says, and we have the answer to save you from this problem. What is the answer? More technology. The technology to make technology simple. Of course, that's what they're saying. So just wait until we have that, you know. It's like that. So it becomes more and more complex. You'll be so sick of healing modalities. You will become so sick of it. That'll be your uber disturbance. At that, you know. Oh my God. I've got a trillion mantras, and I've got a trillion drugs, and I've got, you know, light therapy, healing therapy, vitamin therapy, this therapy, I gotta eat, do this. And after a while, you've got this super problem, right? You got the super problem of too many problems. Too many disturbances, too many healing modalities. Absolutely, that becomes then this untreatable problem almost, right? And that's when you freak out. You say, well, wait a minute. What's really causing me problems is I've got too many healing modalities for all these problems. And how do I do? Oh my God. Well, that's where the spiritual teachers come in on the scene. It's like, hey, wait a minute. All I gotta do is I gotta just exchange all these problems and all the healings and treatments for all these problems just for this one problem. Problem of feeling jittery about, whoa, I feel jittery that I'm on thin ice, I'm about to break, you know, I'm on the brink of no disturbance, I'm on the brink of no problems. This is my problem. This is my only problem. This is my only problem. We better make this exchange quick. Better repent quick. Just look at repentance. It's that. Okay, trading all problems for this one problem. That is repentance, okay? It's a very good way to look at repentance. Be a repentant spirit, that's all. We don't have to put it into some uber religious context, really, right? We can put it in this disturbance context like this, absolutely. We don't have to talk about Jesus or the Holy Spirit or Buddha or any of this stuff. Not necessarily. We can if somewhat. We don't have to, no. See, if we can streamline and simplify it, it's just this, be repentant, just exchange all these problems and heal and modalities of healing, whatever, addressing these problems in any which way, exchange that just for this one problem, very severe problem. Okay, I'm afraid that I'm on the brink of no problems at all. See, doc, going like a doctor, psychiatrist, doc, he says, what's your problem? He said, doc, I got this really bad problem. He says, what's that? I feel like I don't have any problem. I'm on the brink of not having any problems. Now, it depends who the doctor is, you know. If there's one, the worldly doctor, they'll say, wow, that's a really terrible problem. We've got to work on getting you some problems, you know. Or if it's this doctor, quote unquote, then Jesus say, okay, great. Just hold on to that problem. Okay, we want you to hold on to that problem. It's a great problem. That's the only problem you have. Just say, okay, I own the problem. This is my problem. I'm going to own it. This is it. This is the only problem I have. Just stay with it then. Okay, now we're going to gradually evaporate that problem. So, two different kinds of psychiatrists, right? Either it's Dr. Jesus or Dr. Hyde, you know, like that. So just be a repentant spirit. That's all you have to do. That's all you have to do. Makes all the difference in the world. Literally. All the difference, yes. Literally. Really. Sidestep the future. This awful trap of too much healing modalities. Trying to address every single doggone problem, thinking this is the problem, this problem. You know it's coming. You can see all these advertisements, this stuff. It says, you know, we just discovered this new problem. You may have these symptoms. If you feel this way and this way and this way, if you're not sleeping well, and if you have this, you probably might have this problem, and we got a new drug for this problem. This is just going to go on and on and on until you just absolutely are so freaked out by it. You're just going to go into a funk. Then you go to the psychiatrist and say, what's wrong with me, doc? And they say, well, we're working on another medicine for this. It's in clinical trials, actually. You know, I've been working on it for some time, and shows a lot of promise. Shows a lot of promise. And you might even be a candidate for it, you know. Yeah, well, okay. So I say all these things in the video with all total compassion and urgency, knowing exactly how it feels to be in those states of feel you have no options, feel at the end of the road, the doctor says, yeah, we got some drugs coming down the road. You're just, you know, the end of the road. You just can't even, you know, there's no response. You're just flatlined almost, right? I know exactly what all of that is like, and so I'm addressing all this, you know, directly, with all urgency. That is not a joke. That is not a joke. Getting into this state of just hopelessness, and just feeling like, oh, I just gotta wait, even though I know it's not gonna help me, probably gonna make me feel worse. Right? nobody knows the answer. You get this feeling like nobody knows the answer. And if they did, it's not relative to my problem. But we're just showing right here it absolutely is. Because the answer is to trade your problem in, no matter what it is, for this one problem that the one we really have is like, I got this problem, I'm right on the brink of no problem. No problems, ever. Right on the brink of it. I feel like I'm just almost there, you know. It's like, wow, this is the one problem everybody has. Everyone has this continuity problem, other than those who've already, you know, realized this and the continuity fear is gone, but they used to have it. Okay. So this is the one fear, the one problem everybody has. So again, this does address your issue. No matter what your problems are, no matter how flatlined you are, no matter how apathetic, however just hopeless you feel, this does address your situation. So it does address all disturbances. It's saying trade all disturbances, no matter what label they are. Don't worry about any label, what the label is, blah, 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 blah. You got the psychiatric, the diagnostic manuals, got every, you know, just endless labels for all this stuff, right? I've read the old doggone thing, you know. It just goes on and on and on, right? And changing clouds, let's label it this way, and let's label it that way. And that's just the tip of the iceberg. There's really infinite disturbances we can imagine. Doesn't matter, labels don't matter at all. Just trade it all in for just this one problem. I'm right on the brink of no problems, Doc. What do I do? Just say okay. I'm just gonna sit here and shake a little bit. I'm just going to be indeterminate about it. Do I do this? Maybe. Do I do this? Maybe. Do I do this? Maybe. Do I do that? Maybe. Do I do this? Maybe. And then just be quiet and just stay poised in a full stop in this indeterminacy, full stop in this trouble, just full stop in this. It's just, this is evaporating, this one fear that we have, that's all. Because your spirit already knows the truth. It's shaky. It's feeling shaky. Just feel shaky. Say, okay, I feel shaky. That's fine. I'll just feel shaky for a while here. That's all. As you're doing this, you're a repentant spirit, and you're evaporating your continuity fear. You are being treated. You see? You are taking the medicine. So you're on the road to recovery. It's that simple. So, keep it simple. Alright? Very great. That's it.